we left off talking about the structure of the pigments that are responsible for absorbing the photons of light, the energy in the photons of light, and conveying those to a reaction center in a photosystem that will then elevate electrons that will be then passed on through an electron transport chain to generate a gradient of hydrogen ions. So let's go through that now. Before doing that though, let's look at some accessory pigments. There are, in addition to chlorophyll, which we've just gone over, there are secondary pigments that can absorb wavelengths at light that are other than chlorophyll A. And that increases the wavelengths of light that can be used in photosynthesis. So the accessory pigments that can be found in photosystems are chlorophyll B, carotenoids, phycobiloproteins, and the carotenoids also act as antioxidants. So carotenoids get their name from carrots. Carrots are orange, as you know, and carotenoids are the yellowish-orange in color. These pigments are yellowish-orange in color as opposed to the green chlorophyll pigments. And you know that eating carrots is good for you, and that's because the carotenoids present in carrots act as antioxidants. And antioxidants remove reactive oxygen species from cells, and those reactive oxygen species can be very damaging. So, excuse me, the carotenoids in the photosystems act as antioxidants as well as light-capturing photopigments. And that carotenoids are really the reason that in the fall we have bright orange colors in leaves. As senescence occurs for deciduous trees in the fall, the chlorophyll molecules in the photosystems are degraded before the carotenoids are. So the majority of pigments in the photosystems in leaves are chlorophylls, which are green. And as they are degraded as senescence accrues in the fall, the carotenoids are still present and they shine, they show through. And so we see bright orangish red colors in the fall. So now let's look at the photosystems that contain these photopigments that harvest light energy. The photosystem consists of several components. One is an antenna complex, and there are hundreds of pigment molecules found there. Chlorophylls, chlorophyll B, chlorophyll A, other chlorophyll molecules, other accessory pigments, I should say. Carotenoids, phycobiloproteins, and so on. And there is a reaction center that has two chlorophyll A molecules located there. And it's the job of the antenna complex to funnel energy harvested by the absorption of photons, to funnel that energy into the reaction center. And it is at the reaction center that electrons will be elevated to a higher energy state and be passed on to electron carriers. And that passing on, the passing down of electrons, will allow work to be done. And that work, just like in cellular respiration, the work that will be done will be primarily the pumping of hydrogen ions across a membrane. In this case, it's the thylakoid membrane, as we will see. So the energy of the electrons is transferred through the antenna complex to the reaction center. So here we have a schematic of this process. We have the absorption of a photon of light by accessory pigments in a photosystem. So the photosystem consists of tens of proteins, lots of protein molecules, and then pigment molecules embedded in that protein complex. And the pigments that are absorbing the energy in photons of light pass that energy. They don't pass electrons on. They pass the energy to other accessory pigment molecules. And eventually, that energy will be transferred to the reaction center containing two chlorophyll A molecules. And it is at that point, the absorption of energy by the reaction center that elevates an electron to a high energy level. And that high energy electron will be passed on to electron acceptor molecules, as we will see. And then those electron acceptors will pass that electron down a chain, which will then allow the pumping of hydrogen ions across the thylakoid membrane where the photosystems are embedded. Now, what we can do is look at an actual three-dimensional structure of a particular photosystem. This is photosystem 2, involved in photosynthesis, oxygenic photosynthesis in land plants and algae. And as you can see, this is a very complex structure. The pigment molecules are represented here in space fill, and the protein by a gray backbone. And the pigment molecules are color-coded according to their chemical identity. And I'm not going to go into too much detail about this structure at this point, but you can see that a photosystem then is a complex of pigment molecules and associated proteins that orient the pigment molecules in an antennal configuration that will funnel electrons to the reaction center at the center of the photosystem. So we've talked about the transfer of energy to chlorophyll A at the reaction center. And we talked about the excited state of the electron there in the reaction center. And we talked about the excited electron being transferred from chlorophyll A then to an electron acceptor. Now, that excited electron has left a photosystem in this case. And water then donates electrons to replace the electrons that are lost in this excitation and transferring procedure. So the ultimate source of the electrons then for this whole process of capturing light energy, elevating electrons to high energy, and then passing them on, those electrons are replaced from incoming water electrons. Water is then oxidized to oxygen, and the process is oxygenic then. This is an oxygenic photosynthesis. Water donates electrons to reaction centers which have lost electrons due to this energy excitation process. And we can schematically look at this process as follows. So here's light being absorbed by a photosystem, and especially that energy being transferred to the reaction center. That results in an electron elevated in energy being transferred to an electron acceptor. So that electron acceptor accepts that high energy electron, and that will pass the electron on to other acceptors as a way to do work to pump hydrogen ions that will be used for ATP synthesis in chemiosmosis, as we've discussed previously. But that electron that is now lost from the reaction center, from the photosystem, to an acceptor of that electron, that needs to be replaced, and that is replaced from water. When that happens, the energy in the electron is in its low energy state, and the water now loses loses electrons and will generate oxygen as that process proceeds. It will be broken into hydrogen ions and molecular oxygen, and then we're ready to restart the process by the absorption of light and that electron being elevated to high energy levels. So this is a cyclic process, but it must be. It's not cyclic in the same way as certain bacteria run cyclic photosynthesis. Here, we must replace the electrons that are lost by photosystems by the oxidation of water, by the donation of electrons from water. That's why we need to water our plants. Now, in oxygenic photosynthesis of the kind we've been talking about, we'll leave some other non-oxygenic photosynthesis for a few minutes. We'll come back to that. But in the major forms of oxygenic photosynthesis, we can break the light-dependent reactions of photosynthesis, the part that's dependent upon light, into four stages. We like to break things into stages, so let's do that. We have a primary photo event where a photon of light is captured by a pigment molecule in a photosystem. And then charge separation involves the transfer of the energy absorbed by the pigment molecule from the photon. We transfer that energy to the reaction center in a series of steps, transferring that energy to other pigment molecules, which pass the energy on, and such that an excited electron eventually is generated in the reaction center. And that excited electron becomes transferred to an acceptor molecule. And that acceptor molecule is going to be NADP+. So in you're used to seeing NAD plus, not NADP+. But in this case, what we have is NADP+ being the electron carrier. And that NAD plus takes electrons and becomes NADPH. So NADPH is the reduced form of NADP+. So NADPH is going to carry electrons and pick up those electrons from eventually from carriers, from electron carriers that are transporting the electrons initially donated by a photosystem. Now, in oxygenic photosynthesis, where does that photosystem get electrons to replace those that are transferred to the carriers and that eventually are involved in the reduction of NADP+ to NADPH? Where do those electrons, how are they regenerated? Those come in from water. The electron donates those electrons and that generates oxygen, oxygenic photosynthesis. So, in addition to NADPH being generated eventually through electron transport, there's also the production of ATP by chemiosmosis, because as electron transport passes electrons down an electron transport chain, this, much like cellular respiration, that electron transport, the loss of electron energy in a series of transport reactions, can be used to do work, and that work is the pumping of hydrogen ions across the membrane that the photosystem and accessory electron transport proteins are embedded in. And that membrane is the membrane of the thylakoid deep within the chloroplast. So we can generate then a not only reduced NADP+, that is NADPH, but also we can pump hydrogen ions from the stroma of the chloroplast inside the thylakoid, so into the internal part of the thylakoid. And that proton gradient can be used by chemiosmosis to produce ATP using ATP synthase. We get to see ATP synthase again, one of our favorite molecules. So here we have two molecules that are going to be produced in this process of the light-dependent reactions. One molecule, remember, is going to be NADPH, and the other molecules are going to be ATP. And these two molecules can be used then to drive the endergonic reactions of carbon fixation. So we can fix carbon from carbon dioxide into carbohydrates like glucose. And this process, fixation of carbon, occur in a biochemical reaction, in a series of biochemical reactions that we call the carbon fixation reactions, or the Calvin cycle. You'll remember the Krebs cycle. Well, this is the Calvin cycle, and we will examine this. Now, everything up until Calvin cycle, everything has been light-dependent reactions. But the fixation of carbon and the Calvin cycle are light-independent reactions. So they are light-independent, and we'll cover those shortly. There are bacteria, the green sulfur bacteria and the purple non-sulfur bacteria, that do not use water as an electron donor. And instead, they have cyclic electron transfer in which the electrons are not replaced by water, but rather are cycled back to the photosystem. And that's where we'll pick up with in the next part of this lecture before moving on to the two photosystems found in plants and some bacteria and algae.